Hello, everyone. This week commemorates the discovery of the body of the young boy Andrei Ushchinsky. That was the incident that sparked the Beilis trial of 1911-1913, an extremely important trial at the beginning of the 20th century in the Russian Empire. The Beilis affair was one of the last gasps of Tsarism in the late Russian Empire period. It surrounded the trial of Mendel Beilis, who was a fairly nondescript Jewish worker at a brickworks factory in Kiev. In March of 1911, a young boy's body, that of Andrei Ushchinsky, was discovered mutilated in a nearby cave, and at his funeral, the notorious Black Hundreds anti-Semitic organization distributed flyers like this one claiming that Ushchinsky was actually murdered by Jews as part of a plot to capture his blood for the Passover celebrations that were upcoming. Beilis was arrested and was held in custody for 2 years until his trial took place. The charges of ritual murder were aggressively prosecuted by the Russian government. Although this charge, which had gone back centuries, really to the 12th century, the idea that Jews somehow, you know, killed Christian children, God forbid, for their blood for Passover, and was considered widely discredited around the world. Nevertheless, this Russian government, an extremely powerful government in the 20th century, actually prosecuted Beilis on the argument that he was participating in this age-old rite, which was completely absurd and made Russia really the laughingstock of the international community. An extremely distinguished team of lawyers was assembled on Beilis' side to counteract the tremendous resources that the Russian government had brought to bear to prosecute Beilis. And during the course of the trial, which had many irregularities, it came out that what had happened that day, the last day of young Andrei's life, he had gone to visit his friend Zhenya, who was living in a home that was rife with criminal activity. His mother, Vera, was in particular associated with harboring criminals and dealing in stolen goods. And according to much of the testimony, an argument broke out that day in which Andrei suggested he was going to reveal Vera's activities to the police. Many of the observers at the trial, including one of the police investigators, believed that Vera was actually the woman who was responsible for the death of young Andrei with several accomplices. And there were a lot of suspicious occurrences that happened after the trial, in fact, to Vera and her children. At any rate, after several weeks of trials and long deliberation, the jury found Beilis not guilty of the crime, but at the same time, they agreed that a ritual murder had in fact taken place. So on the one hand, they did not feel there was sufficient evidence to convict Mendel Beilis, and this made him an instant hero worldwide, but at the same time, they bought the Russian argument that Jews did in fact engage in this activity, which did not bode well for the Russian Jewish confidence in their state. The legacy of the Beilis trial is really quite complicated, but just to identify two specific issues. One is, you know, Mendel Beilis became an international hero, eventually moved to Israel, later to the United States, and his experience was celebrated by Jews worldwide as a kind of final defeat of the blood libel. Of course, this was not to be the case because the Nazis would later revive it. It was celebrated in this book, The Fixer, by the novelist Bernard Malamud, that won both the National Book Award and the Pulitzer Prize. In the Russian Empire, however, things did not bode well for the Jews living there, nor for the government headed by Tsar Nicholas II. Nicholas II had allied himself with the Russian Black Hundreds and had aggressively prosecuted Beilis, arguing that, in fact, you know, this was part of a historical phenomenon. And when he lost the principal part of the trial against Beilis, there was a tremendous amount of resentment directed at Jews. And ultimately, this would contribute to the loss of confidence in the Russian Empire as a Reichsstaat, not only among Jews, but among the international community, and would contribute towards its downfall just 3 years later, 4 years later in 1917, with the collapse of Tsarism and the rise of the Bolshevik movement. Well, thank you very much for watching, and I hope you have an excellent week.